Okay, so before we start, I would like to give a big welcome and thank you to the professionals on stage. Our four panelists today are representing both traditional public and charter schools. And I'd also like to give a warm welcome to our moderator, Ms. Marianne McKinnon. Marianne is the Assistant Dean in the College of Education and Allied Studies here at Bridgewater. Many of you probably have seen her smiling face. And so Marianne is going to facilitate the panel, engage the audience, and allow you to ask questions for our panelists. So without further ado, I'd like to turn the panel presentation over to her, and thank you and enjoy the event.
Hello. Okay, where are my student teachers? You guys look so professional. I'm so proud. Abby Kelly, I wanted to meet those people because when you look at the school cancellations every morning, they're always the first one on the list. So even though I know nothing about that school, I wanted to see who the Abby Kelly people were. So that's too bad. We've got some great panelists here today. So let me tell you who you are going to have the opportunity to hear about the hiring process from and also a chance to ask them questions. To my left is Melani Galante. Melani is the assistant principal of the Advanced Math and Science Academy Charter School in Marlboro. Melani has been employed at the charter school since its inception in 2005. Prior to her move to administration, she was a world literature and English language arts teacher with over 15 years of secondary classroom instruction. Melani received a BA in English with a minor in secondary ed and theater arts from our own Bridgewater State University. So welcome back to Bridgewater, Melani.
Thank you.
Next to Melani is Matt Joseph. Matt presently serves as principal of the Memorial Elementary School in Natick. Prior to coming to Natick, he was the principal at the Hill Roberts Elementary School in Attleboro for 5 years. As principal, Matthew presented both at MESPA and the ISTE conference on 21st century school design. Additionally, he has served as district technology specialist in the Berkshires and has taught third and fifth grades in Pittsfield, Massachusetts. So thanks for coming, Matt. Next to Matt is Brian McCann. Brian has worked in the Swansea public school system at his alma mater, Joseph Cafes High School, for the past 23 years as a teacher, as an assistant principal, and as his principal for the past 9 years. Brian was selected as Massachusetts High School Principal of the Year in 2011 and currently serves as president of the board of directors for the Massachusetts Interscholastic Athletic Association. Brian, congratulations on your award. That's very exciting. And Karen Meyer. Karen Frances Meyer is the principal of the Charles S. Ashley Elementary School in New Bedford. The Ashley School is a K-5 community of 338 awesome learners. And her claim to fame for me is that the Ashley School was recently welcomed as one of Bridgewater State University's newest professional development schools in 2012. Ms. Meyer has worked in a variety of K-12 schools as a teacher and a counselor in not only the United States, but in Japan as well. So welcome, Karen. All right, at this time, I've got some canned questions, and I'm going to start getting things going with our panelists. First of all, we'd like you to address about the hiring process in your school system and how that works. So why don't we start at the end, Karen, and we'll work our way back towards me.
Okay. In New Bedford, we do a lot of work with School Spring. Applications are also accepted as paper applications. Resumes are part of the application process. We advertise in El Mundo, which is a Cape Verdean newspaper, in the Standard Times, and electronically. The website of the school department is the best place to look for job openings.
And School Spring, Karen, they can access that? Is that, that's an area where you place listings?
Yes.
Okay.
You can do one application on School Spring, put all your information in, check what you're interested in, and they just dump jobs in your email account day after day that are
great.
Available.
Is that free for them?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
Okay, great. Do any of the other schools use School Spring at all?
Yes.
Okay, good to know. All right, Brian.
Hi, Swansea is a very small district, so when you hear about people having human resource managers, and does it go to the, no, it goes to my office, it goes to my desk, and I have to kind of separate the wheat from the chaff in terms of resumes. Karen's school, we subscribe to School Spring, which has been a godsend in order for us to cull the best candidates here. We also post on the DOE's job site and look for matches here. But I think the best way is going through the school district's website and check it early and often to see if there are postings. But when you're looking at a small district, I bet many are like myself, that they come to me and I'm the almost the final say. I will present the final candidate to the superintendent for her imprimatur.
Great, thanks.
In Natick, at least the last 3 years, well, we have a School Spring account. We also have a website that you can apply to, but I'd say 98% of the people we hired in the elementary school the last 3 years have been either from the Bridgewater, BU, or Leslie Job Fair. We want to see you, we want to take 2 or 3 minutes, and then we're going to either say we want to see you back or thanks for your resume. From that point, we actually, the five of us, one of the five elementary schools attend those three job fairs to gather the resumes, and we actually sit down for a 15-minute screening with all of the candidates we felt at the job fairs we wanted to see again. We have a 15-minute screening with probably, last year we had about 8 openings and we saw 60 people in 2 days and then brought 15 back for an interview. At that point, again, all five of us will interview the candidates. And the reason is with five elementary schools, you could be at my school 1 year and a different school the next year. We want at least a say in who are the finalists. And when we get down to people we feel would be qualified to teach in Natick, then the individual schools would interview that candidate with their teacher leaders and maybe a parent of that grade level and teach a lesson. And that's how we've hired, and we've been thrilled with all the new teachers we've had the last 3 years.
Yeah, Melani, you're at a charter school, yes. So you're a little different than the three schools represented here. Can you tell us a little bit, first of all, about the charter school?
Sure.
Are you affiliated with public school districts, and how about the hiring process there?
Charter schools are a public school. We are our own district, so we have autonomy on who we hire. My school is a little bit different. Yes, we use School Spring, and we pretty much use it exclusively, but we also have postings on our website as well, and there are a couple other places that we post, but School Spring really, honestly, as you heard from all four of us, is probably the best bet for you to apply. What we do, our process is a little different. We have department chairs, as we're a 6 through 12 school, and the resumes come in and they go directly to the department chair of the job that you're applying for. That department chair will then look at the resumes, and sometimes it depends, again, because it's exclusive, you might get a telephone interview, then an interview. Every person does a model lesson. Then there is an interview with the administration, and we put some input in, but ultimately it's the department chair that hires you. So we're a little different in that sense.
What about licensing, Melani? I know there are two kinds of charter schools.
Yes.
Horace Mann that requires licensing and Commonwealth that doesn't necessarily.
Right. Commonwealth charter schools do not necessarily require licensing. The way that the law works is that you need to pass your MTEL exams within 1 year of hire. However, with the way that the state is changing things, especially with the new evaluation system that's come into place, charter schools need to follow that. Most charter schools are going to be looking for a highly qualified teacher and that they've passed their MTEL exams. We do. We expect that. But there is some leniency and some leeway with the charters.
Great. And how many openings do you have in your school districts or schools, and in what areas are you seeing the most amount of openings? And we'll just kind of open that up if you guys want to weigh in.
I actually called and asked Human Resources today. We will be needing in New Bedford sheltered English immersion teachers, physics, biology, math, elementary 1 through 6, special ed at all levels, computer teachers, middle school science teachers. And I know I personally will be needing either a third or fourth grade teacher and a special ed teacher.
Usually I'm looking for between 5 and 6 teachers and a staff of about 50 here. This year I'm lucky, at present, I have no openings. It could all change tomorrow if someone decides they want to retire, if someone's spouse takes a job in a different part of the state or the country, someone decides they're going to go out on leave, maternity has, we have had many blessed events at the high school recently, which you know, do kind of throw a wrench into the hiring process here. So at present in Swansea Public Schools, we're probably looking for one elementary teacher system-wide, but that could change on March 22nd.
I agree with that, and last year, I can just say in our new teacher opening remarks by the superintendent, we had about 25 total people in there for Natick Public Schools. I know in the elementary school, we hired about 8. This year, we're looking at 6 currently, but the day before school started, I needed to hire somebody because somebody took a different job. So if you don't give up, if you have a tough round of interviews or you don't get something right this minute, because over the summers where a lot of action happens, keep your, you know, keep your phones on and keep checking because things change and are very fluid throughout the year.
Yeah, the same. We currently we don't have any particular openings. There's a potential guidance. I don't know if there's any guidance people out there that we may have. But again, anything can happen. We average anywhere between 5 to 10 openings a year. But right now, because we are at full capacity and we have a pretty good retention rate, I would say potentially 3 to 5 this year. What they're in, it depends on the teachers. There's always, you know, a little bit of turnover or last minute, as you said, maternity leaves, things like that, that will come into play.
Great. I'm going to deviate from the questions for a second because I'm the moderator and I can. I'm going to ask you a question that my office gets asked a lot. A lot of these folks are out in the field now. They're doing their student teaching, and they're plodding through their programs. We have to wait at the university for practicum grades to get posted, in many cases for degrees to get posted, which can take a while. Can they apply for jobs now? Will they be taken seriously? You know, they're not going to have the license in hand. They are able to get from their universities, and we've got folks here from other universities as well, usually letters saying, yep, so-and-so is wrapping it up. It's just a matter of documentation and the state processing the licensing thing. Is it okay for them to start the process now?
For us, absolutely.
Yes. Absolutely. You're at the benefit of that because you do not cost a lot of money to employ. So use that to your advantage.
Absolutely.
That's the realistic. When you're looking at an elementary opening here, at least in Swansea here, they're going to look at new teachers who are going to come in Swansea somewhere around $40,000, give or take a couple thousand dollars, rather than perhaps look at someone who is going to be $15,000 more than that with an advanced degree. You coming out of an accredited state university with your certification, all your ducks are in a row, you do have an advantage in there. It's probably one of the few advantages that you have. And if I had to look at that realistically, for some things it does come down to dollars and cents. New Bedford's looking for a physics teacher. You, as the certified physics teacher, have the power there.
Yeah,
you want
it,
you want to be a special ed math teacher? God bless you. You have a lot of power here.
A lot of
elementary,
power.
Secondary history teacher. I have 700 resumes under yours as well. That's the reality of here. Will we consider people who are, everything's pending? Yes. I want to know if your MTELs are that you did pass your MTELs, that your transcript up to date is reflective of someone who has had an academic experience rather than a social experience at their university. The most important thing on your resume is that it is not a Sudoku puzzle for me. So for me to figure out what your degree is and what your certification area is, whether you have that certificate number in hand. If you're old school like me, you had it mailed to you from Malden. Now you have to make a Xerox off the ELAR for it. I want to know what you're certified in, at what levels, and your degree, so I can determine if you are highly qualified.
Mm-hmm. That doesn't give you extra time now to say, oh, I can wait because I can apply and not have the certification. The urgency is still there to mm-hmm. push that through.
It is. It's also, with classes ending in May, it's going to give you a few weeks before the end of school, and most school districts get out there and substitute.
Yes.
That is a wonderful way to get your face and your name known, especially if you're a competent substitute, because there are not that many of them in the world. If you can keep 30 young children in a room, no one climbing out the window from the third floor, the principal is not called to the room to bring the National Guard in to regain control. There have been no medical emergencies. Right then, you're looking good at that school department. So a lot of schools take people off their sub list, because when those openings pop up on Labor Day weekend, and they really do, I wouldn't want to be climbing in the Himalayas on Labor Day weekend if you want a teaching position, because lots of schools across the United States hire right up till the end of the first week of school. You're trying to figure out how many teachers you need. You want enough, but nobody can afford to have too many at this point in time either. So you're not going to say, oh, let's just hire 10 teachers. You're going to wait and make sure you really need them. And those calls come in at the last minute. You want to be ready. You want to have everything ready to go. But substitute, absolutely. Try and get in and substitute. Volunteer. If someone at your local school still remembers you, and it's not a painful experience for them to remember you, get in and volunteer in the school. You are golden. You're CORI approved. You're literate because you've passed the MTEL test. You have a college degree. You are just exactly what schools are looking for to get in and help students. So get your face out there. Be present.
To piggyback on that, when you do get into that particular school system, even though there's, you know, maybe only a few weeks left of school, of course, with all the snow, you might be working until July. Gives you some more time. But please be confident enough to even ask for a recommendation for whoever you volunteer for or work for. That recommendation can go a long way as far as looking at other job opportunities. Keep in mind that, you know, we have connections as well. So if you're working for one of us or anyone and you apply to another district and you get a recommendation from us, chances are we know who this person is or this person is, so you're going to rise to the top that way as well. So keep that in mind. Be confident. Don't think because I'm only here a month, you know, I don't need to have that.
And it goes both ways, because sometimes I know you'd mentioned about the last minute person turned down the job at the last minute, you know,
absolutely,
a school's expecting you. All of a sudden the candidate says, oh, I got a better job offer here after already committing to a district. The K-12 system is a pretty small system when it comes to getting a reputation for leaving somebody in the lurch like that. Mm-hmm. So
and
you just
we
have
all
to
talk to each other. So we pass that information around from school district to school district.
Yes.
And as a follow-up to Brian's comment, Brian, as a mother of a secondary ed candidate in the field of English, and I know that that's one of our more flooded fields, and you had brought up history, and I think elementary might have been the other one. What can folks here who are sitting here that might be the area that they're seeking licensure, what can they do to beef themselves up to make themselves rise to the top of the pile that you had mentioned?
It's an excellent question. I have my degree is in English. I was an English teacher at Joseph Case High School for 11 years before I became its assistant principal. I would say you need to have an intimate knowledge of the frameworks, or right now, you know, how it crosses over with the Common Core. In English, the big, you know, the emphasis that 70% of your reading will be nonfiction by high school, I don't mean necessarily in your English class, but to have a knowledge of that. What kinds of conversations are going on in English language arts and literacy, which is what the Common Core Common Core stresses. If you're an English major and you're interviewing with me, I'm going to ask you, what are you reading now? And if you and that will speak volumes. And that doesn't mean if you're reading some trashy novel during the summer, I applaud that. I think you should read a trashy novel in the summer. But I also want to say, you know, I'm finishing this, but I just reread, Ellison's Invisible Man here, and it became more profound to me at 25 than it was when I first read it at 16. I might ask you what your favorite book is that you had in high school or you had in college. I think that speaks volumes about it. But have an idea about the battle that English departments are having now in the transition from being so old school literature focused to the demands of the Common Core. And you can do a lot of work on your own just to coach yourself up with that, or learning, or looking. The New York Times has a wonderful series called The Learning Process, which talks about all different relevant issues that are going on today. Coach yourself up so you know what is happening. Many curriculums are available online.
Yes.
for the school system you're going to. You need to do your homework. I shouldn't have to educate you all about Swansea when you come to see me. Mm-hmm. I can tell you some things, but it'd be nice if you told me or asked me some questions based on your research. You have to show me that you want it as well. But if you're going to be an English teacher, you better be a knowledgeable English teacher. I once interviewed a man who I was, what is your favorite American author? And he told me Charles Dickens. Thank you so much for this interview. It's been lovely to meet you here. And it was over then.
There wasn't enough chuckling going on here. You folks got that, right?
You also brought up the elementary pool is flooded. Yeah. One of the downfalls I see with the elementary student teachers, and you all do the same thing. You have 300 hours. Your state school is the same as the other state school, so you do have to separate yourself. But you also need to be flexible. When I interview a student teacher, and they come in and say, oh, and they give me all the information about grade 2 in the openings in grade 4, and they can't speak to it. And yes, it's all encompassed in the elementary school, but during your prep time or during a free period or during any time you have, go visit other grade levels, sit in other team meetings. Because when you come in and limit yourself or limit your experience, you're already limited in your experience having 300 hours essentially, at least expand it to other grade levels. I know that there's requirements for the higher ed graduation. I'm not saying don't fulfill your requirements, but be able to speak from my school's K-4, your school's K-5, at least the range of students within that school. I wrote it down for a question later, but it was one of the things that you should do to set you apart is be flexible. I had someone come in and say, I'm a great grade 2 teacher, that's all I want to teach, what's your opening? Grade 4, have a good day. So be flexible, see other grade levels, go to professional learning communities, go to the staff meetings, go to different things that you can speak on, not be totally knowledgeable and maybe able to say as much as you are about your student teaching level, but at least have some knowledge of what's going on in the fifth grade classroom if you're doing a first grade student teaching.
Well, I think we heard a little bit about enthusiasm too. So enthusiasm Absolutely. For the content area, Brian, and being able to speak knowledgeably about new issues in the field like the Common Core state standards and literature that you're reading.
Yeah, I think relevant issues. Yeah. I don't think you need to tell me all of your bells and whistles and an obscure thing that you might have studied, but if that's your passion, I'd be interested in. One thing that you might look in, this is more on the secondary level, if you're interviewing or you're looking at a specific district on their website, they probably are somewhere in the accreditation process with NEAS, right? Whether they're somewhere in that decennial process. And in most school districts in this day and age will publish their self-study report online, which will give you volumes of information about that school district. High schools should have, in 2013, core values and 21st century learning expectations. How are these core values and 21st century learning expectations emphatically connected to what goes on in the classroom? Is this revealed on their website in the documents that the school district have put out? What can you infuse in your interview about the school? For example, if one of the core values are communication in a school, I think you want to make sure that you have effectively communicated that is a priority to you as well if you're interested in having a job in that town.
Great. And then I think we heard from Matt, diversify your choices of grade levels. If you're an elementary person, grades 1 through 6, have the span of experiences there. It's why we make you folks diversify your field placements. We don't want you spending all the time in the same high school that you exited out of a couple of years ago. We want to make sure that you can speak to all those different grade levels and all those different ranges of students, urban students, suburban students. Karen, I think you had something to add here.
I did. when Brian was talking about secondary ed with the Common Core, the push for literacy across
Thank
the
you.
Curriculum now is enormous.
Thank you. Absolutely.
If you want to be that one history teacher out of a million that's going to actually get a job in September, mm-hmm. you need to know how to bring reading and writing into your social studies curriculum. You need to know how to bring math into the social studies curriculum. If you can pull across the Common Core into your subject area and you can portray that to the person that's interviewing you, you're going to jump ahead of the other people that are interviewing for that job.
Absolutely.
It will make such a difference. But nationally, our focus is going to be on teaching literacy across everything, art. If you're going to be an art teacher, you better figure out a way to get reading and writing into that art curriculum. Do some thinking now. If that hasn't entered your realm of consciousness as a student teacher, talk to your teachers. Find out what are they doing. And if they don't have a clue, find somebody that does, because it's going to make a difference between you getting a job and not getting one.
The other piece too is, as I think it was Brian said, when you're applying, when you're a humanities person, I taught English as well. I started off in the private sector, and that's how I got a job. But we had a history opening last year. We had 252 applicants that came into school spring within 72 hours. not all of them are opened. And rightfully so, especially as we talked about last minute, they're not going to look through 250 applications when there's a week to school. One of the beauties behind School Spring is it tells you if your resume has been opened by the district. It actually sends you an email that says that your resume is under review. I highly, highly suggest that you follow up with an email to whatever the name is, from whether it be human resources or the contact person there is to submit your resume that way. Because quite frankly, our history department chair went through the first 20 that came in and was able to find a candidate. That's how it works. So you want to work fast, look at your deadlines, but don't think you have until that deadline to submit an application, especially if it's online. And to follow up within after the deadline, within a week or so after that deadline, to see where you stand. Very important. If you have to make yourself present in order to be made known, especially in the online world.
Great. Now we have about 40 minutes left to pick the brain of these great hiring folks that are here today for you, and we do have some microphones down here, so come on down. Any questions you have about the hiring process, what will make you more marketable?
My name is Andrew Talbot. I graduated from Bridgewater State University in January of this year. I've just been certified by the Department of Education and Secondary Ed. I wanted to direct my comments specifically at Brian and Karen. I've currently taken the hard road, and I am a history major, and I'm looking to get involved in social studies and secondary ed. And I'm currently employed as a substitute in 9, soon-to-be 10 districts as a substitute, doing everything from 6th grade on up. I'm licensed for 8 through 12. I'm actively involved on School Spring. I'm making sure not to have the National Guard come in and rescue me. I have not had that happen yet, and I've developed a fairly good reputation wherever I've gone. Being aggressive that way, is there anything else that I can do, networking, to keep improving my chances, or just keep running and running and running like I'm doing right now and push for something to open?
Well, one, I would say congratulations for jumping right in there. That's a great start to begin with, and good for you for being out there and substituting. It takes nerves of steel to substitute teach, and wonderful. There's in the elementary curriculums, and I don't know if this is going on through the middle schools and high schools, but there's a focus on literacy, building literacy. Discovering Justice is a very large program. The law school in Dartmouth, is working on training teachers in the Discovering Justice curriculum. It's being written nationally. It's for kindergarten and first grade right now. They're planning to add 2 grades each year. The intention is for it to go through middle school. I don't know whether seeing if you can hook up with some
definitely that sounds
other
like,
organizations.
I'm very interested in working on literacy and involving a lot of things in the common core, particularly with historical documents, because in my experience, just from doing my student teaching and from doing substitute work, that's something that's been very difficult for a lot of students to work through. So I'm trying to brainstorm and come up with ways to work on that. But I'm definitely interested in anything that involves social justice and law, because mm-hmm. that's somewhere in my interest. I'm very much a researcher as well as a teacher.
Lots of educators do volunteer work in social justice areas outside of their schoolwork. It's a great place to network. Okay. Look into doing something electronically, whether you start a blog or pick up a website. Have teachers, if you have the time right now to do research, pull resources together. It'll get your name known.
Fantastic. I don't want to take up too much more time.
I would embrace every substitute teaching opportunity you can have. That's how I got my start in education, was as a substitute teacher.
We all did.
I had terrible experiences.
I've only had one.
Still have nightmares.
Right, and it made me a stronger person. But I did not get under the radar of the principal as someone who was problematic. It was someone that the secretary could call at 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning, and I was ready, and I never said no to an assignment. And I did that for a while, and then that turned into a long-term sub-gig. And it's those long-term sub-gigs. So, I said the blessed events. Embrace mm-hmm. the blessed events, because mm-hmm. you can benefit.
I'm still waiting for that long-term call. I haven't had one yet.
But they're out there. Beautiful things are happening all the time, and you can profit from them.
But also, make sure you learn the secretary's name of the schools that you substitute at.
Good.
They have a lot of power.
How long, you were student taught in the fall, right?
Yes.
How long did it take for the state to give you your license?
Believe it or not, a little less than 6 weeks.
Good.
I applied on January
Very good.
3rd and I got it on Valentine's Day.
I'm asking because we're engaging in a new batch licensing.
I was not expecting it that quickly.
I'm glad to see it's planning out then. That's great. Marilyn, are you here? Is Marilyn here? She's the one who does licensing, and she's going through a lot of work to get those licenses processed through this new system, and it looks like it's working for us, so that's great. Any other questions? Oh, great.
My name is Jessica Croto. I'm kind of in a different situation. I've done many years of teaching, elementary, substituting, and I think everybody should be a substitute, special ed. And now I'm doing my practicum for principal, assistant principal, administration. And as 3 principals up there and 1 assistant principal, when I start putting out, now I've only done, I'm not working, so I have the luxury of being at the high school 3 days a week from the start of school to the end of school and, do a lot of different things. What can I do to make myself stand out when I apply, obviously I being a high school principal, I would probably be assistant principal first, or a dean of students, or?
Practice doing observations and writing up evaluations. I think that's
under the new system.
How many, I plan on doing 2 with the principal.
30.
Yeah, easily.
Serious?
Not observing of you, observing all the people sitting behind you. And getting into classrooms, seeing what good teaching is, being comfortable giving feedback, both positive and having those difficult conversations with a teacher when the lesson doesn't go very well. What's going to make you a good principal, you don't need to be a good teacher, you need to recognize what good teaching is. So the more time you have in classrooms observing teaching, not being observed by whoever classwork you're in, that's going to make you marketable to a superintendent.
Just to dovetail on what Matthew said, I think if you had an intimate knowledge of the state's the template for the evaluation tool, looking at the 4 standards, the indicators, and elements, you can't believe what they have us doing. you can't believe what they have. The compilation of evidence. And as new teachers, you will be on that non-professional status for 3 years, and you're going to have to cull that type of evidence starting day one. So know the difference between a standard and an element and an indicator. So because we're all learning with that. To do evaluations, the district we do them via an app on the iPad called Teach Point,
yes.
Which has been very,
yes.
Which I've liked. I don't know of any other district.
Yeah, we use
on,
it.
We do them by
on hand. The iPad. But,
Teach Point?
Yes.
Teach Point, love
okay.
it.
They have an app for that.
Yes. They do.
Look for it. I bought an iPad mini just, you know, for those kind of things. I have to do one formal surprise observation. I want to do two specifically because I co-teaching. I want to see good and bad and
needs improvement. There's not bad.
Yeah, nobody
needs
bad.
Improvement. And as a special ed teacher, and totally believe in co-teaching and the models of co-teaching, do I need to tell the principal that I'm going to go observe this class, I'm going to go observe that class, I'm going to go observe that class? Because I'm there 3 days a week, and I'm there till the end of June.
How honest a feedback do you want right now in front of our audience?
I want honest.
I think you need to switch your thinking. I think you're thinking of observations in the sense of go in, sit down, look, watch for 40 minutes.
It's not like that.
You got to go in every classroom for 10 minutes,
yeah,
do it for 2 weeks straight, and look for patterns within that instructional style.
In fact, come to my booth. We actually have learning walkthroughs that we're doing at our school,
okay,
that are connected through the Charter Association.
Okay.
I can absolutely get you with that, and that will really show you. We go through multiple classrooms in about an hour and a half,
okay,
and you'll start looking for patterns, which is different from sitting down and doing a 45-minute
right.
observation. It's shifting.
Right, I have to do one of those.
Right, but the expectation for the administrators is to do 10 observations a week.
Oh.
10. So if you're
we're
doing it from that perspective, then and each teacher needs to be looked at between 8 to 10 times a year. You can't do that in 45-minute segments. So really what you're looking at is anywhere between 10 to 20-minute segments and creating a pattern that way. So that's,
it's not necessary for me to tell the principal. I just go to a class. I mean, they all know me.
I think you should talk
to them.
I think you should
come up with a game plan.
I will talk to them about it.
Absolutely.
But switch your thinking of what your expectations are.
Absolutely.
And take
also,
Melani up in her offer to come
will
and
be
see
more
her.
Than, you are more than welcome to come to our school. We have 2 dates.
I will definitely do that. And one of the good things that the school did is they have Hawk News. And I was interviewed. The principal was interviewed. And so it goes on TV. It was a nice little thing, funny and serious. So everybody knew who I was, because a lot of people didn't know who I was.
Great.
And I thought that was awesome, and I got a lot of good feedback. So they know if I walk into a classroom for 10 minutes why I'm there. And
It would be the relationship between you as an observer speaking with the teacher about their practice afterwards that's going to make the most difference.
Okay.
And if there's not a future for you in that school, if you're not planning on being there in September as part of the staff, I think I'd be looking for someplace else to spend some of my time during the week right now.
Yes.
If they're not going to hire you, then look, get yourself out there. It's not that easy to find a principalship.
No, I understand that, but...
All right, well, I think we're going to ask for more questions now, but definitely take these folks up on their invitation to come talk to them upstairs. Any other questions from the group here? And just to talk to the teaching folks here, that new evaluation instrument that the panelists are talking about, you can get information on the State Department of Ed's website. Hopefully you're not totally unfamiliar with that if you've been through our program, but take a look on that because there's lots of information about it. Okay.
Hi, my name's Stephanie Reynolds. I'm a graduate student at UMass Boston. So I'll be licensed in school counseling 5 through 12. If you're going into a school counseling position, everyone applying is going to have a master's degree. We're going to be licensed. We've passed our MTELs. What is going to make us stand out from other candidates?
Understanding the culture of the school and the demographics of the children. You need to do your research on that. Mm-hmm. You really do. That I've been through several interviews with guidance, and that's the one thing that we look for is, did you do your homework with our school? Do you understand our kids? And you know, again, personality, good fit, that part of it is key.
And those student demographics are located on the State Department of Ed's website under
yes.
school district profiles.
Yes.
Click on students, and it'll give you race, ethnicity, and socioeconomic class. But if you also click on selected indicators, it will give you the number of students who are limited English proficient, the students whose language is not English, their first language, lots of really special ed populations. So there's a wealth of information on that site.
Also, what else you can offer? As you know, guidance takes on various different roles. What else have you done? What can you offer?
I would be interested. So you had to do like a million practicum hours, right, for this?
Yeah.
Right. So instead of me, you, it's like fiction writing. I give you this situation. What would you do if this and blah, 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 and you make up something here? I'd want to know in your counseling practice, what have you done?
Mm-hmm.
Give me a real life scenario of something you did, some problem with a child that you found from the beginning, middle, and end. What were the agencies you might have brought in? How did you bring the village together to help this child heal? So give me some experiential thing rather than, oh, if you had $1 million or on a desert island, I don't care about that.
Yeah.
I want to know, what have you, not what you're going to do, because we're all going to save the world in a day, I know that, but what have you done?
Okay.
What have you done? And then, so if I knew you had your practicum experience at such and such a school district, then I can, you know, reach out and find out how did you interact with students? It's school counselor. It's tough. You can't believe how needy people are.
Yes.
No, they are. It's. I mean, as a principal, I mean, they said, oh, I have to do 10 evaluations. I have to do 5,000 evaluations a day. Sometime half my day is in a guidance office mm-hmm. with some kid in crisis who, you know, mm-hmm. got a beating the last night before, or the mother's in detox, or the father. And I'm from like a middle class, nice. There are a lot of problems out there, and they all come to you at 7:30 in the morning. And you have to be able to get along with adults. And please, in your first year, don't stand there and tell me everything you know and how smart you are and how much more you know about me, because I might not have the counseling degree, but I've been in the game for a while, and experience speaks volumes. You have to learn how to partner and get along with you, as you have to learn how to get along with us.
Collaborate with everyone.
And you have to get your sea legs on this ship. And hopefully it's a great boat and not the Poseidon, right?
Yeah.
I think, too, as a counselor, one of the most important things you can bring to a school is respecting teachers. Mm-hmm. And sometimes counselors feel that they're special and they don't respect the work that teachers do and the really hard having to be with a child all day long or for an hour and a half. You get to see them for 5 minutes.
Yep.
Sometimes it's not the same thing. Bullying is an enormous problem nationally. We're going towards the requirements of having bullying education in schools. I'd make sure I knew about some of those programs.
Yeah, I used to
get my make sure you know how to implement a bullying program in the school. And I also would make sure I knew how to use my community resources to support children in crisis.
And with bullying, what better than Mark right here at Bridgewater State University?
Yeah, great.
I mean,
they're
wonderful.
Yeah.
Have those connections. Have your magic bag of tricks. I mean, you already have those connections mm-hmm. with Mark, and that might, you know, help you rise to
Absolutely.
The top.
The other piece is we actually have a counselor that was unable to find a job that offered to intern for us for free, and we picked her up on our offer. So think about that too, is, you know, coming in one day a week. It depends on whatever your schedule is, but to offer your services to a particular district or two, it's a great way to get experience, gain experience, get good references, and potentially get your foot into the door.
We have some school-based counselors in New Bedford that come from Child and Family Services.
Okay.
And when it comes time to need a new counselor, that's where you go to look.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Any other questions from the audience?
Hi, my name is Beth Riley. I just moved up here from North Carolina in September. I taught 5 years down there in an elementary school. Do you have any advice for out-of-staters?
Beth, do you have a temporary license?
I do.
Beth is hireable
because she's got a temporary license right now. She's got a year to pass that fun with testing.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I think similar to any time you start to go in an interview, where you're going to have an advantage over the people behind you or first years is that you've had some practical experience. I think talking about data analysis and how you've interpreted that data, where student teachers can give some discussion about data analysis, you have done it and done it for a full year. And I would talk about your growth rate of your students.
Okay.
And what have you done, similar to the last question we talked about, don't give 5 hypothetical examples. Give 1 realistic one. Here was an issue. Here's how we analyzed data. Here's how we saw the growth. And here was the end product of that. And really hype up the experience that you had and how that's going to make and translate into the school you're applying for.
And Matthew raises a wonderful point, because so many of the districts that you're going to apply in the public school are race to the top districts. Mm-hmm. So they have to have data teams in their schools, which we all do. What do we do with that data? And if you come in with that experiential, I agree wholeheartedly. Again, that's helping you stand out. Though you taught down south, you need to demonstrate intimacy with the Massachusetts framework, since they are different than the focus in the southern states.
Has South Carolina adopted the Common Core?
North Carolina, yes.
North Carolina. Did. And how many years ago was that?
Well, it was adopted this year, but we've been studying it for about the past 2 years.
So that's a common theme here.
Yeah. And North Carolina has had a statewide curriculum.
Yes.
Yes, because they do things statewide instead of school district by school district, like most places. You do need to learn to speak and spell Massachusetts.
Okay.
Because there's the DESE has a different vocabulary than in North Carolina.
Okay.
So you just need to make sure you can localize yourself, too.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
I think while he's coming up to ask a question, and we said that...
Just jump right up.
Jump right in. Anytime, the advantage that she had about to the data analysis and talking about examples, you can do that too as student teacher, so make sure you capture that. I wasn't trying to say that to just her, that other people couldn't do that. You just have a smaller window to have that opportunity.
Hi there. My name is Catherine Marsters. I have my initial teaching license in grades one through six. And I was just curious, for interviewers such as yourself, you've done a lot of interviews, if you had to choose like the top 3 skills that you're looking for in an interview candidate to prove to you in the interview, what would they be?
Communication. If you can't speak clearly, if you can't write intelligently, I really don't want you working for me, because I'm going to be cleaning up messes that you make for the entire time you are in our school system. That's really important.
Something as basic as proofreading your cover letter. Did you spell, if you're writing to me and don't spell my name right, or you give me some wonderful degree, thank you very much, but you didn't do any research on me. This is going to sound so old school here. Using it correctly. ITS or IT apostrophe S. Using
really?
There. You laugh. You cannot imagine.
You have no idea.
I would be on Oprah if she had her old show.
Do not rely on spell check.
No. Oh. Do not send your cover letter like you're writing a text. It's YOU, not right.
Yeah.
Can you see if
no
you have
smileys?
No, I don't want that. Emoticons have no place in a cover letter.
But you get it.
Besides communication and spell check, another thing I would talk about is how you do any form of RTI, response to intervention. However it's discussed in every district, it's used. The child study process, the RTI, how you are analyzing data and then targeting the learning gaps of students. How you can see both the advanced on target or below target students, how you can sit in an interview and talk about it, because mm-hmm. as a first-year teacher, you're going to make mistakes. You're going to have bad lessons. But if we know that you can analyze, plan, and follow through.
So differentiated instruction.
Not just say the word, but right. knowing what it means.
Right.
And I want someone that can take feedback.
Yeah. And how to set it up. You have to know how to take data and turn it around to make it usable in the classroom to have an effect for children.
Right, and analyze those gaps. Okay.
Right. Keep in mind, too, that by the time you make it to the interview process, and we know we all laughed at the resume piece, but obviously you're not going to be sitting in front of us if you spell it's incorrectly or use it incorrectly. But when you get into the interview, one of the things that we really look for is we look for relatability. Are you able to carry on a conversation with us? Questions? We expect you to do your homework. We are a charter. Charter schools all have, you know, different components. Any school system is right. different. So, you know, if you're coming to us and you're taking our time, we want to know that you're actually interested in working for us. But that relatability factor, yes, the knowledge is there, and they talk about knowledge. But keep in mind that there are probably another 200 applicants, especially elementary, that have a similar knowledge. So what stands out is confidence without being too overconfident,
right.
being able to relate. We look for conversations. We look for student-centered instead of you-centered.
Right.
Okay? It's very important to take your skill set and show how you've used that with the children in your classes and
right.
your experience.
Okay.
Very important.
I'm going to just say a real basic one. How you dress.
Yes.
How you dress should not violate my student handbook. You know what I mean?
That's a good
yes. not dress for the beach. Do not wear... You would say, yeah, I get that, Brian. I know not to do.
You dress.
I mean, schools probably more on the conservative side. Probably more. Dress more for school than you're going out for cocktails afterwards. At this,
obviously,
you know.
It needs to be professional.
Excuse me?
I said, obviously, you need to dress professionally.
Yes.
You say obvious, but you'd be surprised.
It's not obvious. I think it's
people.
Obvious. It's not obvious.
Okay.
Dress professional and lock your Facebook settings.
Oh, we don't
put those on private or on public.
Yeah.
Right. I don't want you. They're gonna look. We're gonna look for you on Facebook, on Twitter, or whatever social media of the day. And if it's, you know, if it's a pictorial representation of your fabulous spring break in Cancun, we might not be calling you back. You know what
right.
I mean?
Now you said they're gonna look at that. Is that a typical? HR
yes.
Strategy yes. for I, looking at candidates yeah. on,
if
on the internet.
If they're finalists, we're going to search for them.
We're going to yes, Google yeah. you. And it's not pretty sometimes.
That sounds indecent.
I know it.
But well, we do tell our students, right from those professional conduct seminars, day one, that, you know, what's out there on the social media and on the internet is there forever.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Leave your cell phone in the car. When you take a cell phone call during an interview, you've just lost any chance of getting a job. And just letting it ring during an interview, enough right there. That's, you're done.
Could I suggest you go old-fashioned and write a thank you note
right.
at the
yes.
end? I'm sure you all have been told that in all your profession, and you're like, yeah, I'll send, a handwritten one's different from an email. I'm
yes,
sorry, it's
it
different.
Is.
You'd rather have the handwritten.
Yes. yes.
Well, you clip
I'll
it.
Take anything.
You clip it to the file. You remember that one because it stands. Everybody
right.
sends email.
Because I think isn't this
out.
Thoughtful that they took the time to spend now 46
right.
cents to mail it? I do. I
right.
It will if you're looking to separate yourself in a positive way.
Right.
You know, mom and dad were right. Thank you notes go a long way. Sure, an email's nice.
Yeah.
Handwritten's nicer. That's just me.
All right, we have about a little less than 15 minutes, and I know there are two other folks standing here, so come on down.
My name is Brian Ross. I graduated Bridgewater in 03 with a history degree, but I currently teach at the Merrimack Special Education Collaborative. We were in the news this past summer for a lot of financial distress. Okay. Could that be held against me if I'm trying to transition out based on the reputation the school has?
Are you the reason
I
you're
say,
in financial?
I hope face was part of the newscast.
If it's not
maybe.
Your fault, then
okay.
that should have nothing to do with you.
But be prepared to talk about it.
Yeah.
I would use it to your advantage. I'd use it to your advantage that you have a history degree, you've been in a special ed setting. We're just speaking here. The special ed populations are not decreasing in the public school system. You have
yeah.
a special ed background. You are highly qualified in history based on your degree. I assume you're certified as well as a teacher.
Well, that transitions to my next question. I have a prelim in history. Yeah. All I have to do is my practicum for my modern special needs in 5 through 12.
Yeah.
Will that, if I'm not 100% licensed, will that limit me as well based on people coming out of school who are already fully licensed? Because I have 9 years experience teaching.
If you're going to teach special, I want you dual certified. I want you history and moderate special needs. Okay. The moderate disabilities is...
Huge. It would put you ahead of the pack.
But think about it. If you worked in a venue which had you on the radar in a negative light, and you're a survivor of that, and you turned it into a positive, your children benefited from that. Use it to your advantage. Could be the best thing that ever happened to your career.
Even though I still have to do my student teaching, if I were to get hired, say next year at whatever school district, would they be willing to support me with the student teaching piece too?
No. Not usually.
Okay.
No, get that done.
Get it done. Get it over with. You also have the fact that you graduated in 03 and you're a little bit more grown up. Mm-hmm. Most school administrators would think that you're a little bit more mature. It's not necessarily true.
Look at him. You think he's more mature?
Well, I'm optimistic. I'm trying to buff him up here. But sometimes you would rather go with somebody that you know has moved on from the college days a little more and... We could get focused on being a grown-up.
So essentially, push through what I got, finish the student teaching piece, and then...
Yes, you know, absolutely. Push, get it done.
And that history, contributes to you being highly qualified in the area of history for special ed students, because that's something that's looked at, especially if you're at the middle and high school level, so that's really important.
Yeah. And again, look at the literacy piece as well. It'll make you highly marketable if you look at literacy as well.
Absolutely. A lot of schools put social studies and literacy together.
Yes.
So you're going to be, especially in SPED, where you're going to be doing the two subjects together.
Right. Thank you.
Hi.
Hello.
My name's Nancy LeBlanc. I'm a student here at Bridgewater State University. I'm currently getting my postmaster's in school counseling. I have a previous degree in rehab counseling and worked for Mass Rehab for 14 years, helping folks with disabilities go to work. But I have a question for you. I'll be done with my practicum in December of this year, and I was just wondering if I don't have a job lined up right in December, would you also recommend as a school counselor that we get on all of the substitute lists as well and do student teaching, but substitute teaching as a way to network? Or would you recommend a different path, more like what you said in terms of volunteering your time free of charge to get known? Just wondering for other ideas.
I think it's a risk if you are going to student teach without a teacher background, because it may end up...
I didn't mean to say that. I meant to say substitute teaching. Because earlier I heard that substitute teaching was recommended if you didn't already have a job to network. Would you recommend that for a school counselor as well?
I would go the volunteer route, because it would be in your specialty.
Okay.
Or something that you're passionate about that you could bring to a school in your interview whenever that may happen.
Okay.
Because my current counselor... filled in for a medical leave in November, and then the person didn't come back. Mm-hmm. And now she's full-time.
Oh, that's fantastic.
So I think finding something in your field to help a school along will make you better off in interview time.
Okay. I appreciate that.
It's also, with being ready to go in December is not necessarily a bad thing.
No.
Teachers that have second half of the year birthdays, many of them are going to decide to wait till December 31st to retire because it's going to bump up their retirement pay.
Okay.
So that's an important time to look for positions also.
Okay. I hear you.
I'm going to take a contrary view on this here. I think, with all due respect to my colleagues here, I think that a counselor who has some teaching experience is very, very valuable. Sometimes I've had people that's just been solely counselors, and they don't know what goes on in the classroom. So maybe it's not your dream job, but certainly if doors are not opening for you in the counseling venue here, I would consider a per diem thing, because that's something you can bring to the plate.
Okay.
I know what goes on, at least in a limited capacity, in a day-to-day classroom situation. Maybe it's different an elementary substitute, which must be awful to be in the same room with the kids for 7 hours here. whereas they transition at the high school, whether you're at block scheduling or a more traditional one, you would see more. I think it's something else you could bring. In my own counselors and in my school. Some have teaching experience, some do not.
Okay.
But the ones who have teacher experience do have a sensitivity or have a perspective, or they can see the world from that purview. So I don't necessarily think it's a bad thing. So you kind of get mixed messages.
No, that's okay.
Up
it's all
no, that's what it's all about, though. Thank you.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
Helpful.
Thank
and
you.
And if you play a sport, look for a coaching position and try and work your way into okay. a school that way, too.
Absolutely.
You know, if I could just dovetail on that, what Karen says here, I think we're looking wrong. I know we're looking for people who don't want jobs, who want professions.
Yes.
And that means get involved in your community. Yes. If you're at the high school, go to a game, go to the play, go to the art show, go to the music concert. Even if it's terrible, you tell the children you sure. did wonderful.
Absolutely.
And it's not like Little League everyone gets a try, but you're there to support them and in their journey here. I want to see my new teachers at events, be in the faculty basketball game, dodgeball game, whatever it takes.
Okay.
Volunteer. If someone's at the school dance and they're looking for chaperone, even if you're the substitute teacher, I would love it if the student teacher said, hey, I would love to get a couple hours. Could I help chaperone the dance? Absolutely, come on down. Okay. You'll hear some great music. Right.
You'll see what not to wear to an interview.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Absolutely.
That's excellent.
We have
Thank
time
you very
for
much.
One more question, and voila, here is our questioner.
Hi, my name is Kristen Ryan. I'm wondering what you look for with beginning teachers who don't have that much experience on their applications and your resumes. What you look for.
I look for flexibility, we talked
okay.
about that. I think knowledge of the district, we talked a little about that.
Mm-hmm.
And how you're gonna make me look good. Come to the interview and say how you're gonna jump into the school committee and how you're gonna work your skills. Because in, let's say Natick, I'll use an example, if everyone here applied, six of you are getting a job in the elementary school. Why are you different than the other 56 people who did 300-hour internship? How are you gonna make our school system better? So although you have limited experience, there's things that we can't teach or we can't support you with, and you have to bring those to the interview.
How limited are we speaking of? I'm not sure.
Well,
did you do student teaching?
Yes.
Excellent.
Yes.
Then capitalize on that.
But
it was the best 10 weeks of your life. Why?
Yeah. And like Brian said, you're cheap.
Yes.
Yes.
Inexpensive. He didn't say cheap.
No, I know.
I'm sorry.
I would say cost effective. It sounds so much better. So that's...
But look at, go on the school or the district website, find their school or district improvement plan,
mm-hmm.
yes.
and
That's
read it.
That's a good one, too.
Find out what the basics are. Find a way you can support that. And if you don't have anything in your background or your experience that lets you feed into that and support that plan, then you've got, 24 hours before an interview? You better find something that's going to make it work for you. So Matt had said earlier, do your homework. It's really important. You've all crammed for exams. You know that, it's tomorrow and I'll worry about reading the syllabus for the class tonight. You can do that. You've done it for 4 years, at least in college. You can do it for an interview too. Think about it as another final exam. Make sure you know your district and your school before you go in for the interview, and you can find something to connect on.
I think it's a fallacy that districts are always looking for a good match, because we don't all want the same people, but I do want to know how you are going to sparkle in my school. So if you only have that day, find a way to sparkle.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Now, you guys stuck it out, and we really appreciate it, because some people go right to the job fair and skip over this very valuable session. So I'm going to give you something that nobody else upstairs will have unless they're in this room right now. I'm going to ask each of our panelists to reflect on one question that you typically ask a candidate when you're interviewing them. So get out your pens, guys, because we all wish that we knew the questions ahead of time before we go into the interview. So this is your opportunity to get a sense of what those questions are and be prepared to respond to them. So why don't we start? Okay, Brian's got his hand up.
I got it right up. I'm going to ask you, tell me about your parent communication or family communication here. And you're going to tell, well, Johnny was an idiot and this one. And I'm looking for, did you ever call home because someone did something good? Did you ever praise someone who wasn't expecting it. When I was a teacher, and I had a student who was on the autism spectrum. She had Asperger's, and this was years before when people really didn't know a lot about it. And she went from a C to a high B when I calculated the term grades at home. And I called the mother that night because I was so proud of her growth. And she worked like a fiend to get that grade here. That was a great call home, and the parent still thanks me for it when I bump into him at the market. What positive phone calls have you made? It's not all that Johnny was a jerk today. Okay.
That's very good.
Thank
advice.
You. I appreciate
yes,
that.
Absolutely. I never get those calls ever, and I have
well,
a senior
all,
in high school.
How many emails we get thanking us for a teacher.
Yeah.
You know, Mrs. Hoo Hoo did this wonderful in class, and my kids, you know, so happy about you know,
absolutely.
Is calculus now, if you can even imagine here. I want to thank you for that teacher. I'm forwarding that email to the immediate free world that to celebrate.
Absolutely.
With
absolutely. Absolutely. When you can make a parent cry for a good reason, that's really nice too, because that stays with you longer than the many you make cry for negative reasons.
All right.
Always a classroom management question. How do you deal with the child who is constantly off task, who is hurting other people, who is disruptive, who is reading 3 years below grade level? You're going to ask, especially in an elementary classroom where you've got possibly 30 kids and you have them all day long with the doors closed, and you've got to find something to do to keep that child from hurting others and so that he learns something too. My question is always going to be about management and how you deal with that one child that you would like to make disappear.
I always talk about goals. I like to know what your own goals and how you're going to exceed those. So what would be your goals for next year if I was going to evaluate you? I also ask, what drives you crazy? Like, know that. I know I hate when people are late. So when I work with a team, I like to communicate that. Let's make sure we're on time. So you know yourself in that sense.
We have a couple questions that we always use, and the first one is we ask about a success story that you've had with a student. We ask you to go through that. Then we follow it up with a struggle story that may not necessarily have turned out the best and why it didn't turn out. So we're looking for, you know, honest feedback of the pros and the cons of teaching, and also, you know, have you had that opportunity to reflect upon those experiences? Because teaching is not just about getting into the classroom, but it's about reflection, learning from the mistakes that you make, and growing from them. So we do that.
Great. So got it all down, guys? One quick question. Should they be expected to do a sample lesson when they're in the hiring process?
Yes.
So all of your schools require that.
Well, if you
not Labor Day weekend.
Yeah, if it's in July and we have an opening, we can't do it. But I've been at this job fair many times, and we've had candidates come in, and they look great on paper, and they had a great handshake, and so personable, and then they get in the classroom, and you're like, oh my goodness gracious, that's not going to work. Or they blow the socks off you, and then you talk to the kids. How was it with that one? That's, oh, I really like that. I don't know, Mr. McCann. So we've done it if time allows during the school year. But then we're up against, I don't know my openings for next year at this point.
Right.
Within this year, and it seems that the other districts may. But I think that's an excellent way. You know, are they willing? Okay. Can they walk the walk? Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah. No.
We'd really torture and say, good, I don't know, second or third, good luck. When you get here, we'll let you know. Let's see how you're doing.
No, so if you're
quantum physics, be prepared. You know,
yeah,
just,
we'll say
we don't do that.
What we do in Natick, 30 minutes around this topic, and, you know, be prepared to talk about what you taught and then your reflections after.
Great. I want to thank our four panelists for coming here today and sharing all of this information with us. So valuable. And I want to thank you guys for asking really great, intelligent questions. You know, this is a great opportunity to pick these folks' brains, and you did a good job, and you took every opportunity to do that.